Welcome to a special team-up of Neon Jazz interviews with the host of the wonderful jazz podcast and radio show, Something Came from Baltimore, Tom Gouker. Tom graciously invited me to talk about an iconic album at length, and I picked Miles Davis's Birth of the Cool. I'm all for it. While Tom was needing some convincing, we get into all of the angles on this album and so much more. Always great to catch up with Tom, and I recommend that everyone subscribe and get into his wonderful programming. He's a gem in the world of broadcast jazz journalism. It's always an honor. Enjoy this episode put together by Tom.
Something Came from Baltimore. My name is Tom Gouker, and I will be your host today. Something Came from Baltimore is a jazz, blues, and R&B podcast and radio show, and it's not really about Baltimore. Today is a Why Is It Good episode. We do this from time to time, where I interview a talented musician, author, or tastemaker, and they choose the album of their choice, and we deep dive track by track. We find out why it is good. So I got a tastemaker, actually a smart, legendary podcaster all the way from Kansas City, and it is the host and creator of Neon Jazz. Neon Jazz has been on the radio since 2011 with the host Joe Dimino, and he is here today. The album Joe Dimino had chose was an early classic from Miles Davis, the 1957 release, Birth of the Cool. It's a landmark recording, and we're going to get into it. But first, don't forget to subscribe to Something Came from Baltimore and play the show volume up and down, because we need that credit. And second, while you're subscribing to my show, subscribe to Neon Jazz. Normally, our artists do not cross over or overlap, so it'll give you a wider jazz music experience. It's hard to find new music, and between both of our podcasts and shows, we got it for you. Okay, so let's do this. It's Why Is It Good? It's the Miles Davis, Birth of the Cool. Joe Dimino, welcome to Something Came from Baltimore.
It's always a pleasure to see you, Tom. Thank you.
We came up with this idea of Why Is It Good? That's something that I do on my show. Professionals pick an album and explain why it's good. And this time, what did you pick?
I picked Miles Davis's Birth of the Cool, which is just an iconic album. One of the things that's so iconic about this album, it was one of the early periods of his life where he actually made a change, which he did throughout his entire life. But this was one of those marked changes where he was kind of saying, you know, to the world, I'm moving in a new direction. I mean, he ushered in bebop and these movements that the old figs would say they didn't like and they were resisting. But man, if it wasn't for Miles and these innovators, we wouldn't have what we have today in modern music.
Now, okay, so I begged you off this album because it's not one of my favorites. And I was like, oh, let's do this, let's do that. And I said, look, I'm going to be a big boy. And I even woke up this morning and said, I'm going to be honest, I'm not loving this album. I want you to help me with it. Now, okay. I understand that we're talking 66 years old. The album was released, but that was 7 years before it was actually produced. When it's only 32 minutes long, and I keep on listening to it, and I keep on looking at it going like, oh my God, how many more tracks do we have? There's something wrong with me internally that I can't get over the hump. Today, you're going to help me get over the hump, and I did research on it, so I feel like I understand what happened. I feel when you're a podcaster and you have a jazz radio show, this is sacrilege. right now, this album is ranked number 19 of the best albums of all time for jazz in the top 1,000 albums of all time. I believe it's like 329. So it's a landmark. How did this evolve? How did this become a landmark album? Do you know offhand?
Well, I will tell you one thing right now. My son, his name's Miles, so that gives you a little bit of where my leaning is. But the one thing I think that's very key about this is that the gateway drug for a lot of people to get into jazz is Miles Davis, and It's Kind of Blue, okay? So, of course, once you open that door, And for a lot of people after that, they kick the door open. Miles and his catalog is very iconic, and it's very it's very emblematic of that time period. Like, this was in 49. That was a golden era of jazz. And that late 40s into the 50s, there was so much that was going on. It was lightning speed. Everything that came out was this wondrous, like, world of serum that we all still sip on right now. And that's what this album epitomizes to me. So your question, I'm sorry, I deviated a little bit. Like, why is it ranked so high?
Is this a landmark album? You kind of explained why.
I think the one thing is that it was a non-ed, and there were so many people that were on this, and that whole big band concept kind of came, like, the big band era wasn't really happening at that point. And for him to get an assemblage of so many talented people all together at once, and quite simply put, which is the reason why I love jazz, it's just this feeling that washes over you. And as you know very well, being a host, there's albums and there's feelings that come in. So I don't know that I would need to convince you any more than you're convinced about this album. You don't even have to like it, because at the end of the day, that's the beauty of all of this, is that we all have these individual vibes and feelings that go into it. And we just, it works for us or it doesn't work for us. Now, your favorite Miles Davis album, which I've dealt with, if you want to let everybody know.
It's Decoy, but it's personal to me, because it was the first Miles Davis album I ever bought. And yeah, I was a young guy. I wrote down, because I was like, oh my God, people are going to turn this off. They're not going to listen to us because I don't love this album as much as they do. Like, On the Corner, Jack Johnson, Someday My Prince Will Come, On the Decoy, Tutu, Bitches Brew, all of them I'm totally in love with. This one I'm not, and I don't know why. Yeah.
It could be this. This could be the thing that is more discussionable with what us here is. There's a later era of Miles, and there is an earlier era of Miles. And I'm not really into that later era. Like, I can totally get into it and go with it, and I play it on the show. But if I sit down with a glass of whiskey at the end of the day, and I want something that's going to wash over me the same way that whiskey will, it's Birth of the Cool. It's all of those early albums, you know, all of those earlier albums and that library really hit me. But I think the thing that's beautiful about Miles is that he evolves so much. Like, for instance, the heralded son of Kansas City, Charlie Parker, his style pretty much was, a lot of it was the same. Charlie Parker is Charlie Parker. He didn't go through these sea changes. He didn't go through these momentous stylistic changes that charted this evolutionary path, because, like, you got the education around me here. If you took a timeline and you looked at Miles at his arc, there's so many things that were vastly different about what he did. He was a restless soul. I mean, he was a painter. He was, you know, he wrote, he did all these things. But the one thing that's always got me about Miles, when I talk to people that were around Miles Davis, you know, whether it was Gary Bartz or it was Sonny Rollins or it was, Dick Conte, out in San Francisco, longtime broadcaster, they always say one thing about Miles. He listened like no one else. That's why whenever you go and do a YouTube and say the look, his look is that he's sitting there and he's not saying anything and he's listening. And then he gives the look, because the whole time his ears and the way he conceptualized things. So in a roundabout way, I think that's the thing that's beautiful about him. He was so restless. He had to move forward on this sound spectrum that he was gliding down in his magic spaceship that no one could figure out his whole life.
Yeah. I just watched The Birth of the Cool, the documentary, to get into this. Being restless and being a creative and being an artist are number one for him. And always searching, never stopping, even up until right up to the end. I'm going to go through some of the notes that he did play with Charlie Parker, and he didn't play to the level that Parker did, the speed. That wasn't his thing.
Right.
And he felt that he was being abused on stage, that he was, and Charlie Parker was already like on his heroin kick. He died when he was 35. So it's not, he's a young dude. So he had Miles on stage, and he was, when this album was recorded, Miles was 22. It was 1949, and it came in three different sessions. The first session was January 21st. The other one was 4/22. And then the other one was 3/9. And it was, Miles wasn't alone. He was with a group of people who all felt the same thing, is that bebop seems to be like played out a little, and they're playing to their strengths. And the Strengths was this whole new thing called cool jazz. That, to me, I went in a rabbit hole trying to figure out cool jazz. The funniest thing is that this album was recorded in 49. And by the time it was released, Miles Davis was at number 19 on the releases. He had 19 albums recorded before that. This album came out and it was kind of like anti-bebop, but it had a bebop vibe, cool jazz vibe, and a big band vibe. So it was like a melting pot of something that kind of didn't really exist. What's your thoughts on all that? Like, I don't want to say anything I didn't get right.
No, you are right. Yeah. Cool jazz was kind of an outgrowth of the West Coast vibe that was going on. Stan Getz was getting involved with it. There was a lot of cats that were doing kind of the lighthouse cats. I mean, even guys that were on here, from like Jerry Mulligan to Lee Konitz and all of these guys, they all had these like things they picked up from the coast. And I think that's the thing that was so interesting about the way jazz was really roaring, even at that time in the 40s when they were doing this, 40s and 50s. It was emblematic of the place that you were at. Like with Baltimore, we talked about this on the last podcast. There's vibes that you get from that city. The blues was really in a part of the Kansas City vibe at the time when it was roaring on 18 and Vine. And on the West Coast, you just kind of had this lifestyle that was a little bit more laid back, a little bit more ethereal, a little bit more visceral. There was just things of that nature that were coming in. And I think Miles may have, and not knowing for sure, that he may have like gotten around some cats that were from that West Coast era and felt it over there because he traveled so much. That, you know, it just got infused into his music and he found the right assemblage of people to verify that vibe.
Okay, this album came out in 1957. It was recorded in 1949
yeah.
and 1950. So they sat at Capitol, only released one album before then with them, and then released this one. This is where they wanted to go. By the time 57 came, they were already there. Yeah. Those artists that were on this album and Miles were already at a place that they wanted to go, that they've talked about. It was a very intellectual experience because he went to college and he also felt like he needed to be on the streets. He felt that what he was learning in college was awesome. And he was like learning this classical piece. He was meeting people who have come in with different shapes and sizes, different vibes. And then out in the street, they were playing something else. So yeah. he wanted to incorporate that. It seems like the guys that he brought in were also on that same wavelength. So I know it sounds weird, but I look at this album as Graceland's Paul Simon. It was an anomaly of its time. It just kind of came out. It had fusion of stuff that was interesting, like South African vibes, you know, just like funk and like pop and some unique stuff. It was a melting pot of stuff, and it didn't even mesh into the current cycle of what was popular. It was like a weirdo album.
Yeah.
And people embraced it. And I felt that maybe this Birth of Cool was a weirdo album for the time. I could be wrong, but that's how I kind of compared the two.
I would think so. And I would think with an outfit as big as Capitol, they sat on it for a reason, because they weren't releasing material like that at the time. Because, you know, our memory in America tends to be short term, but jazz was the popular music at the time. That was the Beyonce, that was what we see as like the big people now. But at that time, that's what it was. So imagine somebody at that. Remember when Garth Brooks did that album where he had his alter ego?
Chris Gaines.
Yeah, right. And you remember that was kind of like, I'm sure the record label, you know, wrestled with him on that one. I mean, think about Queen when we watched that movie, and the record label didn't want to do the operatic take on things. They didn't want this rock thing to become an opera and to become this thing that they wanted. But look what happened. It became a cornerstone of pop culture and what we listen to now. It's a trendsetter, and so was Miles. And that's the thing that was so good about Miles. That's what the record labels, I think, finally understood, is that he was creating something that was eventually going to split off and become a big thing. I mean, I even remember when Steve Jobs released the iPad, he got destroyed for it. The name of it. Why is it called Pad? Why this? Why that? Why does it have to be so big? I mean, it's one of the most revolutionary pieces of technology in this modern era. So in a roundabout way, that's what I'm getting at. Miles was always doing that. I mean, even later in his life in the 80s, he was doing collaborations with R&B and rap acts. He was
Scritti Politti.
Yeah, right.
So it seems to me that I don't know how hot he was on this, because all these songs were released. This is a compilation of like the 78s, you know, with multiple tracks on it that were released during that time period. It was there was two producers on the album. It's Walter Rivers and Peter Giulio, like, worked with Nat King Cole, Judy Christie, Stan Getz. He did the TV theme, the Leave It to Beaver. He was like, how cool is that? Yeah. So it seems to me that he's the one that pushed these songs out. It didn't seem like anyone was really hot for them. They weren't songs that were on regular rotation, like, oh, we got to play this, you know, from 749 to 57. It was like, I think that he pushed it out, and then they're like, oh, wait, we got something here. Like, they were already singles. They were already out there in the ether.
Yeah, and I think that's the thing about it. That's the interesting thing, I think, about discussing these things, is there's always this backstory. There's always this huge backload. And I tend to know things about Miles that are related to this. But I think this was simply one of those things, literally, I think, ahead of its time.
Yeah.
There was just a level of this that the world wasn't ready for it. And man, like I said, how many times has that happened in the world of music, where people are just not ready for certain things to happen? But once it is released the Kraken, it's like it just turns into this stellar thing, you know? Yeah. And like I said, Miles was doing that his entire career. But at the same time, you got to realize too, there was a level of Miles that had a temperament that was... And rightfully so, because of racism, was very skeptical of a lot of things. And I think in business dealings, he was probably very sacred about the way that he was going to let things happen. And part of this could have been him saying, we need to be ready. This may not be the time. Because for Miles, he had irons in the fire all the time.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like if he didn't do this album and release it, that he was going to be sitting around like, well, I don't know what I'm going to do now.
No. The Birth of the Cool is the name of the album. But it wasn't even created at the time. It was the thought process of the players.
Yeah.
So by the time this album got released, they're like, oh, now I understand what the Birth of the Cool is. It was really the Birth of the Cool, because by 1957, these guys were already in that the range of what cool jazz was. And I was like, I guess I don't really understand what cool jazz. They were talking about the background is a warm texture, where the solo is on fire, you know, where the solo takes it. I mean, that's very minimal when you talk about colors and stuff, but it's also a unison, playing in unison. It's also playing off of each other in a playful way. I just think of California artists when I think of cool jazz, and I don't think of this album. And when I hear this album, I don't think of it, but it's Birth of the Cool. And that's why this album title is awesome. Because it really was the Birth of the Cool. So, I mean, it was aptly titled. And they're like, okay, this is the blueprint. This is where we're going to go. We'll get there. And and by the album released, it was like, they're there.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a part of the cool jazz thing was, it was almost like, not smooth jazz, but there was a level of it that was just kind of rearranged in a sonic way. So it was a little bit more palatable by the masses. Not in the beginning. But I think as time went on, that's why this album rose up so high in the charts, because there was a level of this. Because there's a lot of jazz from that era. If you listen to it, it was, for jazz aficionados, it's high up on their list. But for the masses, it's a different thing. Just like with radio now. And I keep bringing these parallelisms into it. But it's really about popular taste. It's how all of these things happen. Like,
definitely.
Like Frank Zappa was like... He was a musician's musician. Everyone loved Frank, and everyone understood his genius. But for the masses, he was not a mass palate.
Mm-hmm. You know, his record's barely sold.
Yeah.
Okay. So. Yeah, you're right. And I'm glad we're having this conversation, because I was going to lie and say I liked it when I don't really
care. No, you shouldn't. Yeah, and I think that's the beauty of art, is like, just like we're walking through a museum, there's going to be a painting that you're going to see, a Matisse, that I may not like, but it may be the favorite thing that you ever saw in your life. Just like that you'll sit for hours in front of it. And I think that's the beauty of the process. There may come a later time where, you know, you might get into it a little bit more, but at this point,
no, I'm 57. If it didn't sink into the core, like I'm a big music fan. If it hasn't done it yet, but I mean, I've heard these songs, a lot of these songs before, over and over and over, and it's not going to happen. There are 11 tracks. They're all like basically around 3 minutes long. They said it was like a nonette, an ensemble. They're calling it a nonette, which is a non-standard example for an ensemble. Like a piano is replaced by a flute of some sort, or there's replacements. I'm listening to it today and I'm like, oh, that tuba is the bass. Like there's a tuba in there. And it's like, that seems kind of really creative. And I was like, and it's rocking. And I think like, I'm like the mixing quality of this album, it must have been mixed over multiple times because one is beautifully, like I'm hearing awesome production value. I'm hearing the drums really high up in the mix where I don't know if it was, but the drums are rock through almost the whole thing. So there is some really cool stuff. Even the piano is in the background. There's only one solo, I think, through the whole 11 songs. But does nonet mean anything to you? I never heard. I mean, I've heard it when I talk about this, but I've never, like, really never say it in conversation.
It's one of those things that I think was kind of coined during this. Every once in a while, I'll hear nonet whenever I'm playing stuff. But I think they've turned that into it's a big band.
When it's all said and done, I mean, because I guess 66 years looking into this, it's been done. This could be the birth of it. And now they have terms for it, but we've heard this many, like I'm a big band lover. I'm like, oh, well, most of these songs, I'm like, I think this is a big band song. Like I've heard this in a big band format. Also, they're very cokey. They still have that bebop coke. Like I'm on coke. I'm like on flyer vibe. Yeah. Some of them.
Yeah.
He was really excited to work with Gil Evans on this album.
He loves Gil. Yeah. They've had a long relationship.
They had a long relationship. And number 19, this album came out, his release. And then I think number 21, Miles Ahead.
Yeah.
So, I mean, they were like, this is Saddle and the Fence. They worked together. They've collaborated through the years. Miles Ahead comes out just two albums after this album.
Hi, jazz fans. This is the founder and host of Neon Jazz, Joe Dimino. It's both a weekly radio show and interviews with musicians from all over the world, like the Netherlands, New York City, and back to Kansas City, the home of Neon Jazz, covering the rich history and modern world of jazz in a fresh way, featuring interviews with the likes of Arturo Sandoval, Sonny Rollins, Maria Schneider, and countless others. Find our weekly show on Mixcloud. Subscribe to the interviews via iTunes and YouTube. We are Neon Jazz.
Talk about the tracks by tracks. Are you able to go in there and dig through the actual tracks?
Yeah, and you know, and I have the track listing here. You know, you start out with Move, which is a perfect term for the beginning of this. In fact, on my show that started Neon Jazz in 2011, I believe Move was one of the first songs I ever played on my first show. Like, it was like, I made sure that I had Bertha Cool on there.
For Move, I said it was very cokey. Big band needs bebop. Like, right there's an example of big band, a sound meeting bebop and that fusion of the two. Yeah. And then that's where I was like, oh, there's tubas in there playing that bass.
Yeah.
And I said, there's some great solos.
Jeru is wonderful. That's Jerry Mulligan composition. Another really nice way of keeping that momentum going from Move.
For Jeru, I said, I know that probably Benny Goodman, Count Basie, they must have done this song over and over and over. This is like a classic. Drums sound amazing. And that's where I was like, oh, this audio cannot sound this good from 1949. It just can't.
Right. Yeah.
So this has to be enhanced and it has a great sound to it.
Thank you. Moon Dreams was a little bit more of like kind of pulling it down. You got, that was a Gil Evans, Johnny Mercer. They kind of pull it down. And then
Moon Dreams, this is my favorite one on it. I like the whole unison in the background and the fact that it does what it says. It sounds like the cool jazz that they're going to.
Venus de Milo, I think I like the imagery. I like the idea of like the birth. There was a level of this that was an artistic birth. And again, that's Mulligan. Mulligan always has such a defined style of things.
The Venus de Milo, this one blew me away. I know that I've heard the song over and over, but I feel that the Kinks from the Village Green Preservation Society, the song Starstruck, they stole it. Like they stole Venus de Milo. I'm gonna play this on the show so people can hear what I'm thinking. But sure. I'm like, I've heard this before. Where is that? So it's the Kinks, and I went into the Kinks. There's no mention that they use this as a reference. So I may be tripping.
Baby, you don't know what you're saying.
Budo, you got Bud Powell in there, arranged by John Lewis. Bud Powell is just like, when you talk about that, that cocaine jazz, it's like, it goes.
I wrote Cokie, yeah.
Yeah. Deception, George Shearing is just amazing. And again, arranged by the great Jerry Mulligan.
I like the sax counterpoint. I just would like it louder in the mix.
You're talking, I'm talking from like side A, that's vinyl. That right there, to me, that is quite a lineup. And then you flip over on the other side and go track 7, Godchild, again, by Jerry Mulligan. And I think Jerry Mulligan, not only on this album, but I think Jerry Mulligan's one of those jazz players that people don't realize how prolific he was and how much people that were big shots like Miles relied on him to kind of keep things in the lane that he wanted it to go in. Boplicity, what a great name. I mean, that's the thing about jazz. Like it was all these cool terms. It was the cool, it was the imagery and the image of Miles on there. It's just like this, like the cool backdrop to a skateboard that you saw when you were a kid. It was just hipper and shit. And it's just, it's awesome. So you go from Boplicity to Rocker, again, Mulligan. Israel, I think Godchild and Israel a little bit the same. I think there was some emotives that were going into that that was getting a little bit spiritual, that was tapping into a whole other well versus just really throwing the jazz out there and getting heavy with it. Rogue is song 11, and it's the final one, and I think that's probably appropriate for the ending of such a album that was Rogue, as we've established. Mm-hmm. So we start with the track Move, which obviously moved pretty well, and we end with Rogue. What a nice couple of bookends for an iconic kind of recording.
And from 8 to 11, I kept on looking at, like, I'm done with this album.
Yeah,
I kept on looking, going like, oh my God, how much more do I have? This is a problem. Like, this is a problem for a classic album. And this album is now on Blue Note. How did it go from Capitol to Blue Note?
Ooh, that's a good question. I didn't realize that. I always thought Capitol had it, but I know that the cover art's changed a lot. And when they do that, when they switch from label to label, they do it. But I think Blue Note just had a time where it just started. There's the functionality, I think, of Blue Note to a good degree, not only being a premier jazz label, is I think they were really master archivists. I think they really want to preserve what they can get their hands on. And they just know how iconic this album is. And maybe Miles at some point had some wish to completely get out from underneath Capitol. But that would be something to look into. That's interesting.
There's only two Capitol compilations, you know, this is including one of them. So his relationship with that label is very minuscule. I'd rather have my archives on Blue Note or Verve or someone who's going to take care of them, you know?
Yeah.
You know, someone. So we knocked this out.
And we did knock this out.
I feel very cathartic. I feel like I've addressed the beast of what this album is.
Yeah.
So this gets to the point where I'm like, why is it good? Final synopsis for anyone who listened to it and got to this part. Why is this album good?
This album represents a very momentous moment in jazz that really heralded a change. But I think more than anything else, to me, as a lover of this music, it represents that feeling, that birth of a feeling that you get when you love a genre of music. Like cracking open that book that you really got weaned on that made you love reading or want to be a writer. For me, this made me want to be more of a listener. And it could have made, this album could have birthed thousands and thousands of other jazz musicians. But at the end of the day, this album to me represents a warm, lovely jazz serum that you will want over and over and over. This is the safe drug.
You know, you're talking about the whole Miles and Mystique. I mean, that's a whole different thing. But, you know, between Miles and Monk, And Mingus, maybe Dizzy Gillespie.
Yeah.
These are real characters. Like Miles is a character. And if you're, you know, digging into jazz history, you can't avoid the man himself and the images and the thoughts that bring into it. This is a part of his work, and he's going to change, and he's going to look as cool as hell doing it. And you're just going to be in awe as to, you know, what goes on. So that's a part of it too. You're on Neon Jazz, now a super favorite fan. I'm like, we bonded to a point where I listen to you almost every day now.
Oh, cool. Well, thank you, man.
Yeah. So I'm like, I don't know how you do it. Like, I think this is hard for me, and I can only imagine what you do with what you do. I really respect your show, and I hope everyone checks it out.
Well, thank you, and I hope they check you out. I'm a big fan of your show, and I think what it is, it's when you find something you love, you just pour it into it.
Yeah,
and then it's not work. It's just something that is a joy, and the more people that can listen to good music and jazz, let's do it. I'm in.
Yeah, you know? and when it comes to this album, I'm not afraid of it anymore. I do understand it. So there could be an opportunity that it sinks in. So I thank you very much for joining me today on Something Came From Baltimore, the Why Is It Good edition of the Miles Davis album, Birth of the Cool.
Always an honor and a pleasure, Tom. Thank you. I appreciate it, man.
We did it. I can't believe we did it. We got it. Thank you.
Thanks for listening and tuning in to another Neon Jazz production, along with Something Came from Baltimore, done by the great Tom Gouker. And we thank him for inviting us. And for everything related to his program, please go on out and find him on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. And for my show, you can find Neon Jazz archived interviews at Spotify and Apple Podcasts. Subscribe to us at YouTube. And for everything Neon Jazz, go to the neonjazz.blogspot.com. Until next time, thanks again to Tom. Enjoy the jazz, my friends.
Neon Jazz.